Hey Carl, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good too. Good to see you.
Good to see you too. It ain't good to see I'm the only person in class, but however, we're gonna make it do what it do.
We'll do what we can do. I'm gonna give it maybe a minute or two longer. And see what's going on. Hopefully
Okay.
somebody else will show up, but regardless, got a lot to cover.
Okay.
Sometimes that works, sometimes it doesn't. All right, well, it's you and me, Carl, at the moment. So I'm gonna go back and I'm gonna just review a little bit about ostinato variations, okay? All right, and they come in two main categories. All right, this is real important. Two main categories. This is ostinato. First, we had a variation form, which we had a theme and a variation came to a complete close. Okay, you remember we listened to you and I believe only we listened to variations, Brahms's variations on a theme by Haydn.
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, which was also known as Saint Anthony's Chorale. Okay,
Right, right, right,
that
right.
was the variation form it's called. All right, and then we have ostinato variations, and they're continuous variations. In other words, they don't stop. They don't come to a complete close like we heard with the Brahms. I also played one or two variations, or the theme, and one or two variations of the Bach Goldberg variations, two classes ago probably. Possibly last class. I just can't quite remember. But anyways, they occur in both instrumental and vocal forms, just so you know. And there are three main forms of it. One is called the ground bass, where we have that continuous ground bass going. And that's kind of like a little bit confusing here, because then we got the passacaglia and we got the chaconne, all right? And the passacaglia has ground bass and the chaconne does not. But the passacaglia is in slow triple meter minor mode usually, and so is the chaconne. So, and then composers named them all kinds of different things, and nowadays we go by Bach's interpretation of that, with the passacaglia in D minor, which we're going to listen to today, at least part of it. Being in minor mode, slow triple meter, but without a ground bass, and the chaconne in C minor, which we started listening to in the last class, which is slow in a minor mode, triple meter, but it has a ground bass. Yeah. All right. I just wanted to verify something. All right. So, back to what we were talking about. So how do these composers make these things continuous? There's really a couple of main ways that these ostinato variations become continuous, and they're often connected by a half cadence. You've got a half cadence, so it's got to continue on. You don't really have an authentic cadence. Okay. That's one way. Another way, because that half cadence, by the way, leaves it just harmonically open, so it's got to continue. So that's important to understand. And a second one is an elision. So let's say we're on a half cadence, and then it goes to one. and right on the and right on the downbeat of one, it starts over again, and so it'll lives together, and that's that could be some people might call that a half cadence, and some people might call that an elision. So that's it depends on how you hear it. All right, it also depends on, of course, how the composer put it together, and another way to do that is to just completely avoid a cadence altogether. All right. And there are some other methods, all right, that are included, but they're not the three major things. But you put a bunch of non-chord tones in there, rhythmic motion that just doesn't go away. And sometimes it moves to the upper voice. So those are other things that do happen. So the ground moves to the other voice, but they still follow into the first category of a half cadence, harmonically open, some sort of elision, or avoiding a cadence altogether. All right. So I'm going to share a screen here. Share screen. Well, Carl, I screwed that up. Let me hang on a second. So this is a chaconne, all right? The chaconne is in triple meter, and it doesn't have the ground bass. I'm sorry. And the passacaglia, which I'm going to share that now, which is what I wanted to share in the beginning. So I'm assuming that you're seeing the Bach passacaglia up here. Do you see the word passacaglia?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I don't know, because what happens is I got three or four screens up here, and then I share it, and then I got to go find it. All right. All right. And the passacaglia clearly has this ground bass. All right. So we listened to an example of it, and I'm going to now share a new screen. I'm going back to the book. So let's see. Do you see the book? It says variations 9 through 12.
Yes.
All right, good. All right, so I'm backing up here. All right, so the passacaglia in C minor clearly has a ground bass. Goes here. Here are the main notes of it. It starts on a C and immediately goes up to G, F, and then it goes A, G, E. So really it's going G, F, E, flat, all right? This A is actually A flat, I'm sorry about that. And then it goes B, C, and then it falls down to G and goes back to C. That's generally how it works, all right? And it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 measures long, all right? So that works into our round little way of doing things. So I'm gonna play this little passage right here that we listened to this before. This is what comes after this. All right, so this is the ground bass, and then we start out with this passage. This is variation 1, and it only picks up the very beginning of it. Remember, it's 8 measures long, and then it's going to fade out, and it's going to come in with variation 2, all right? And it's talking about these agogic accents, where we're accenting something other than the downbeats or right on the beats, all right? So here's an accent, all right? None of them are on the beats. And this is what's tying these variations together. All right, so I have to run away from where I'm at. And this should be it right here. Thank you. variation. He did. Okay, so let's just make a little comparison here. Remember, they're 8 measures long, so I'm just going to draw a little line here. And so, I mean, it's notice the Bach comes in on a pickup here, so there's a pickup, but it's kind of like right here, all right? And I'm actually drawing it. It starts right here on the pickup. So that's the ground bass. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And here it is kind of right here, kind of where it ends. And then it picks up again there. So I guess I probably should have moved this line over. Let's see if it'll allow me to do that. It does. What do you know? So let's just do that, all right? And then, so what we're doing is we're comparing this variation right here with the beginning of this variation and what's really different about it. When I look at it, the rhythm is pretty much the same. Do you see that? I'm looking right here. Yeah, the rhythm looks the same, all right? And the rhythm is kind of the same here in this measure here. But what starts happening is right here, we're changing the pitches, all right? And down here, when I look at this rhythm right here and I compare it to this, all right? So the variation is very subtly different, all right, is what I'm really trying to say. See, this rhythm is all kind of the same. And in fact, it's the same pitches. So I'm gonna go, done that, move this again. So we're looking at here, this and this line up to each other. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and I'm gonna draw it right here. All right. So see how this and this are lining up, but things have changed, all right? There's 2 measures here. This is measure 1, measure 2. This is measure 3. So this is 1, 2, and this is measure 3 of that. So these are lining up right here. So this is the third measure of the first variation. This is the third measure of the second variation. All right, so now we're kind of really changing pitches. Before, in the first two, these upper voices were all the same, more or less, except they did start changing a little here. But now we're really starting to get a change, and now we're getting a change in rhythm between here and here. Do you see that? Just so you know, we're not really getting a change of rhythm, Carl, because what happened is he shifted this rhythm that's up here down to here, and he shifted this rhythm that was down here up to here. Do you see that, Carl?
Yes, sir, I do.
All right. So, I mean, they're really subtle variations is really what I'm trying to point out here. So I'm going to go to a new window share. We're going to listen to a little bit of this. But first, I do want to go back and point out how this is sectionalized out. So new share, book. All right. So you should be looking at the book right here where it says example 717.
That's it.
All right. I think I passed it up. All right, so here is it's kind of more like a macro graph. This isn't a micro graph that specifically points out some things. And to me, this is more of a macro graph, all right? He groups variations 1 through 12. So each one is 8 measures, so quite a few measures, with a gradual increase in complexity. All right, then 13, 14, and 15, it decreases in complexity. And then in the last ones right here, what he does is he increases the density, puts more voices in it, all right? And then at the end, there's a fugue, all right? And we're not going to listen to that whole thing, but we're going to listen to a good portion of it. All right, cancel that. Bring up this. Now share. All right, so that's not the one I want you to see, but this is the one. So we're going to go into the full screen mode. All right, so. This is the Passacaglia. Right there, because this is about to change. So that was variation 1 and variation 2. They were very closely related, okay? And it's going to change right here. Here we go. Those two had some sort of relation, and almost this one does too, or it's building off them. It's almost like he's grouping them in pairs. Now, don't be quoting me on it, but often you see that through Bach. Actually, it looks like he's actually putting 3, 4, and 5 together. And I'm just looking at our book because our book does almost overdoes a job of putting these things together. So this is variation 3 and 4 we just listened to, and now this is 5. Okay, so now we're at 9, and then he groups 9 through 12 together, all right, using similar material. And it goes on, and I realize that sometimes it's really hard to hear that, all this similar material with all this stuff going on the organ, all right? But as a student, and when you start studying these pieces, you start figuring them out. It's often difficult to understand something on one hearing or two hearings. Sometimes you have to listen to it over and over and over to really get the idea of what's going on. So here we go. This is variation 9, and we're going to play variation 9 through 12. I'm just checking to see where we're at. This right here is the beginning of variation 9. So this is like the beginning notes right here, all right? Do you hear me talk when the music is playing?
I barely heard you. I heard you saying something, but I didn't hear.
So what I was saying was, and I'm going to back it up then a little bit here, is let me see. All right, right here, this is... this is the ground bass right here, and it's in the soprano. Do you see that?
Yeah.
So he shifted that up, and this is the beginning of variation 11. So I'm not sure where the audio is going to be at. I'm hoping it's going to be right here. I'm going to back it up maybe just a little bit more. All right. All right, so we're right about here in the audio. So listen, the next two of them feature the ground bass in the soprano, okay? And it's littered by 16th notes. Here we go. Okay, did you hear that ground bass? Now it's not in the bass, mm-hmm. The soprano. All right. But so this is the beginning of the next one. All right, so I'm going to shift to the book for a moment here. So I'm going to escape out of here. $168. Okay, so here we've got, this is how the ground bass is working now. We've got a ground bass note here. All right, that's C, then it leaps up to G, then it's shifting to an inner voice and moving around like that. All right, so then we have, that's 13, okay? He's grouping 13, 14, and 15 together. Here's the C, here's the G, here's the F. All right, so it's shifted into the inner voice there. Let's see what he actually has to say. Variations 13 through 15 make up the second section of the Passacaglia. The treatment gradually becomes simpler. All right, so we've gone through the complexity part, becomes simpler, and the pedal is admitted altogether. These variations contrast with those in the first and third section, and the ground bass is incorporated into the figuration pattern and is not necessarily in the lowest voice. All right, this obscures the original melodic character somehow. And then eventually this persistent bass returns. But when it was in the soprano voice, it didn't obscure it nearly like it's going to obscure it at this point. Okay. Passacaglia in C minor, window. All right, are we back on the score here? Passacaglia in C, no, that's not what I wanted to share. I wanted to share YouTube.
Yeah, because you had drew some red lines, right?
Yeah, that was just in the beginning. Right, this is what I want to share. And then I'm going to make it large. All right, so I believe that we're right around here somewhere, okay? I can't quite remember, but here is the C going up to the G. And then we're going to find the F right here, all right? So it moves in there, all right? So it's not as simple or easy to count. Here we go. Are you seeing the YouTube video here?
Yes.
All right, here we go. This is quite a long piece, and we've really listened now to the first section and the second section, and then it continues on, and I recommend that you go look at it. I've actually posted it in this little section here. Modules. Drives me crazy. If I had canceled out of there, I'd have lost everything. All right, so it's in modules. It's just in this week's module, so it says something like chapter 10 or module 10, chapter 7, continued, and Thursday we're going to work on chapter 9. So it's just in a page called Ostinato Variations. And it's right here. It's the, it's right here. It's the Bach Passacaglia that we've been listening to right here. Okay. And then we're going to listen to the Bach Chaconne. All right. And so I'm going back to the book. All right, we're looking at the book here, right? It says chapter 7.
Right.
All right. So that was an example of something with a ground bass. All right. So all right, here we go. Right, starting from right here, this is called the Bach Chaconne. Now, he doesn't do the job he did before, but he gives you an idea of what's going on. Now, before, we clearly had a ground bass. It was very, very clear. And here, there is a ground bass, sort of, but it's not very clear, all right? So it says, the Bach Chaconne for unaccompanied violin is perhaps the most famous work of its title. It's probably one of the more famous solo works of Bach for violin. But I'm only talking about the fifth movement, all right? There are four other movements. And if you add up the time to those four other movements, the fifth movement is longer than all those other movements. All right, so anyways. The most obvious unifying element in this Passacaglia is, of course, the continued repeated ground bass I'm reading from the wrong place. Bach Chaconne for unaccompanied violin is perhaps the most famous work of its title and certainly one of the finest examples of all music literature of an ostinato variation technique. There is no ground bass in the Chaconne. Rather, the structural unit is a single phrase that is repeated 64 times. Okay. There are going to be some people that say it's two phrases long. All right. So we're just going to go with what this book says. And I think most people will agree with this book. All right. So it's a structural unit and a single phrase stated a total of 64 times. The tonality is D throughout, all right? The harmony remains fixed at the beginning and at the end of each phrase. More specifically, all phrases open with tonic harmony and most of the phrases close with an ostinatic cadence that elides with the beginning of the ensuing phrase, giving continuity to the whole work, okay? Some people maybe don't agree with that, all right? But we're going to go with this because I think it works very well. I can easily hear it going to one and the new phrase starting. So in addition to these common elements, the consistent phrase, continuity, a common tonality throughout and fixed harmony at phrase beginnings and endings, all right? Every variation is characterized by a four-note descent from tonic to dominant. Each of the four notes is usually allotted to a separate measure. The C sharp is sometimes altered to C natural, and the B flat is sometimes altered to B natural. So here it is: D, C sharp, B flat, and A. All right. So let's just look at another share here. So now, in theory, you should be looking at the Bach Chaconne in B minor. It says Chaconne right here.
That's right.
All right. So here it is right here. Now this is not a full measure here. This has only got two beats. That's why I drew a line kind of. It actually should be right here. But here's here's the two. It's in the right place. Here's the two beats that is, and they're saying that it ends right there. So I'm just trying to point out where it ends, but it really kind of is an elision. So this phrase ends right here, and this phrase picks up right there. All right. So, anyways, here's D, here's C sharp, here's B flat, and here's A. And then here's D again. All right. D, C sharp, B flat, and A. Now I want you to also notice that that's almost always coming on the second beat of the measure. See, so if this was a full measure, this would be beat two, but here's beat two, beat two, beat two. Actually, in this case, I'm sorry, I went to the wrong note. Here it is, beat two right here, A. All right. So, and I want you to notice that, let me play it a little bit right here for you. Give me a second here. And here we go. I hope. And now, among the reasons that people might think that this is two phrases together, because they could say that this is A and this is A prime, because it starts out exactly the same. You see that right there? See that right there? This right here?
Right.
This right here. So, and then it modifies it. So some people could say that this is all kind of a five, you know, and then it's not here, and then this is where the real elision is. So it just kind of really depends on how you hear it, all right? So we have to be open to other people's interpretations, all right? And so I'm open to whatever the book says, because we're going by the book. All right, so this thing goes on and on and on like an ever-ready battery, all right? So let me go back and share the book. All right, So then here it's pointing them out. B, and this is beat two, because it starts beat two, beat two, beat two. And this is the 26th time it goes through, all right? And it's kind of an arpeggio, yup, bup, bup style. But here it is right here. It's obscured. Now it's on beat one. Beat one, beat one, beat one, all right? So... variation 14. It's on beat two. All right, because here's the D. Here's the C. No C sharp. It's a C this time. Here's the B flat. And here's the A. But he's also pointing out all the other places it's in. It starts right here. Here's a D. Here's a C. Here's a B flat. And here's an A. And a couple more A's up there. So the chaconne, he says, is divided up as a whole into three large sections. The first section comprises of the first 33 phrases that are in a minor mode, the middle section, 19 phrases that are in major mode, and the last 12 phrases that are in minor mode. So in the past, I would bring this score into class and I would take it and I would say, now we're all going to get lost in this score at some point in time because it goes so fast. So I chose a video that at least keeps up with the score, because what happens in the score is, you should be seeing the score now. So what happens in the score is it goes to shorthand notation. All right. So see how this starts moving really fast? Actually, this score doesn't have that. Well, that's good. It looks like it doesn't have it. So what it does is it plays out something and then it makes you continue to play it like that, but it looks like it doesn't have it like that. This one lists it all out, which is really good. All right, but anyways, let's take a listen to some of these parts here, particularly the parts that go really fast. So here we go, new share. We're gonna go with the box you call. We're gonna enlarge it. We're gonna start it from the beginning. All right, so this is the best score I could find that wasn't a mechanically made score. In other words, it didn't have a real person. It was like MIDI. And this has also been performed on piano quite a bit, I've noticed. Here we go. The Bach Chaconne. It's in B minor. That's the theme in his first variation of it. It's the same, just about. Notice these are starting on the downbeat now. Thank you. I'm gonna turn it up. I can't hear it. All right, see where it says arpeggio down here?
Yes.
A shorthand. Okay, so there's no arpeggio here. So this is why we get lost.
Thank you.
Gonna change key or mode, changing mode to major. Exit out of that. You kind of get the idea of that, I'm guessing.
Right.
All right. Yeah. I do want to go back to that score real quickly and just talk. Did you ever take string class? Can't remember.
Yes, yeah. Right.
So there's a whole bunch of double stops, triple stops, and quadruple stops in that beginning. So, what's going on? Triple stop, quadruple stop, quadruple stop. See that? And they're just running their bow around. And if you look at this, this is the lowest string right here. So if you got four notes, so this has to be played on the G string. This G has to be played on the D string. This B has to be played on the A string. And this E is an open string, the E string. All right. So So it's a really kind of a difficult piece to play. Like here's another quadruple stop. This is G, open G. This is E on the D string. All right, the D string with the lowest note, and the D string is just below that. And then this is D, and you got to play that on the A string. So you got some sort of stretch that you can do on the violin. Apparently, I'm not an expert. And you got B flat up here. All right, you play that on the E string. So it's quite a difficult piece of music. It's also quite difficult to read. Are we all good there? Cool. Still you and me, Carl.
Mm-hmm.
You should be seeing the book now.
Yeah.
All right, so here's the deal. And give me an opportunity to get the page number. We are skipping a chapter here, all right?
Okay.
And we're skipping a chapter, going to sonata form, and then we're coming back. We're coming back to chapter 8. All right. So I need to go to 197. All right, it's sonata form. All right. Sonata form, which Stravinsky referred to as sonata allegro form. All right. And that's to distinguish it to something called sonata rondo form, which a lot of people like say, oh, this is it because it's sonata form, but we can relate it to rondo form. But it's not that significant because the chapter really doesn't make a large discussion on it. And the chapter's long, don't get me wrong. Now, the important thing to understand here, Carl, is that you're not, I'm stopping the share, that you're not dealing with a sonata. We're talking about sonata as a form, sonata form. Now, in a sonata, which is a piece for instrumental music, you could have sonata form. So don't get that confused. We're talking about a sonata. We're talking about sonata form, all right? And it can be, it could be in a three-movement sonata. It could be in a four-movement orchestra piece. It could be a standalone piece, lots of piano pieces. There's all kinds of sonata form. Haydn did all kinds of sonata form. To some degree, he was the little, he really was the person that pushed out sonata form. Most of the symphonies that you've heard of from Haydn are sonata form, the ones you've heard. Realize he had 104 of them, all right? So, and most of us have heard the latter symphonies. They're a special type of symphony, sonata form. It's called monothematic, all right? Mono meaning one theme, all right? So within the sonata form, which we're going to start talking about here, we modulate usually and do a different theme. Haydn always did the same thing in the new key. And part of the reason is Haydn had to put out just a ton of music, monthly, weekly, whatever his, the Esterházys, which was the patron, wanted, all right? Realize he lived in a house and there was like 128 guest rooms. So there was things going on there all the time. So Haydn had to do church. He had to do all these other things. So he just wrote and wrote and wrote. So he used these monothematic forms. Anyways, let me just tell you a little bit about sonata form, and I'm going to kind of repeat it again Thursday in a larger fashion. Sonata form has three parts, all right? One is called the exposition. That's when all the material is presented, all right? And then we have what's called a development, when the composer takes these themes or rhythmic ideas and works them out. And then we have the recapitulation, which is the same as the first, but there are things that change. It's not exactly the same. So that's three parts, all right? So you got the exposition, the development, and the recapitulation. It's the recapitulation is kind of like the exposition. You could call it A, large A, B, and A prime, okay? And that fits into this ternary form idea that the book presented. Now, in theory, three-part form, you could have three different things, but we usually call that through composed. And so sonata form being A, B, and A prime fits right into that ternary form. But it's a much larger scope than most of the ternary forms that we see. All right, often we see ternary form as part form or minuet trio and then repeat the minuet. This is a much larger and much more complicated thing. In fact, you'll find the later symphonies of Mozart, there'll be four movements in them. Three of them would be sonata form. All right. Beethoven, lots of sonata form. All right. So Haydn, he was probably was doing two, but he also did the minuet and trio type of thing and other things like that in his stuff. But he kind of paved the way for whoever came later and realized that Mozart and Beethoven both studied with Haydn to some degree or another. All right. Actually, Beethoven moved to Vienna to study with Haydn. And he never left Vienna. All right. Carl, I'm pausing this. All right. So I'm back to recording. So again, Thursday, we're going to start chapter 9, which is sonata form.
Okay.
We got only two chapters left. And how many weeks do we got left?
About maybe 5 or 4.
Something like that. Let me look at it right now. Boom. Home. I'm just looking at our little calendar. Which I'm going to share with you. Don't know why. All right, so you should be seeing the form and analysis book. All right, so we're in week 10, October 19th. We got this week. We got week 11. So we got the rest of this week, week 11, week 12, week 13, and week 14. We got 4 weeks left of class. All right. That includes final exam. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, Carl, I need you on top of that thing. Top yes, of the proposition. Okay, stage 1 and stage 2 are the hardest thing to do. Period. After that, it's much simpler.
Okay.
All right. All right, I'm ending this for all here. All right, so thank you for coming, Carl. Have a good day.
All right.
All right, bye-bye.